Good morning students. Today we are going to learn about the introduction to the cysts of head and neck region. The various learning objectives which we are going to cover are, we are going to learn and understand the origin and etiopathogenesis of various cysts of head and neck region, and further we are going to study how to diagnose a cyst based on the various manifestations in the head and neck region. These are the various contents which I'll be covering. In order to understand cyst, first we need to see what is the right definition of a cyst. A cyst is a pathological cavity having fluid, semi-fluid, or gaseous contents, and which is not created by accumulation of pus. The point to be noted out here is that it is not created by the accumulation of pus, which is the right definition for an abscess. It is frequently but not always lined by the epithelium. This was the definition given by Kramer in year 1974. Now the components of a cyst. This is the gross specimen of a cyst, how it looks like in the gross appearance. To simulate that gross appearance with the histological specimen, we have various areas, various components to a cyst. For example, we have a cystic wall. The connective tissue stroma in the histological specimen depicts the wall of the cyst, or the stroma or the murine. We have a lumen, the empty space, which can be containing fluid, semi-fluid or gaseous content. And we have an epithelial lining, which is the major source for the development of the cyst. Now the source or the origin for the development of a cyst can be variable. It can be from the reduced enamel epithelium of the lining the tooth, or from the remnants of the dental lamina, that is cell rest of serrae, or the basal cell hamartias, or directly the layer of the primordium of the tooth jaw. It can also take origin from the cell rest of malices, which are the remnants of earthwig epithelial root sheath, or they can take origin from the entrapped epithelium between the fusion lines of the two embryonic bony processes. Now, based on this origin source, there are various cysts which develop. For example, the one developing from reduced enamel epithelium, there are various examples, that is your dentigerous or eruption cyst. The one arising from basal cell hamartias or cell rest of serrae are your odontogenic keratocyst, gingival cyst of newborn or adult, lateral periodontal cyst or glandular odontogenic cyst. The ones arising from cell rest of malices are your periapical cyst or the residual cyst. And the one arising from the entrapped epithelium between fusion lines are your fissural cyst. Now, if the cysts are lined by the epithelium, they are known as true cysts, whereas if the cysts are not lined by the epithelium, they are known as pseudocysts. There are various examples of pseudocysts. For example, the mucus extravasation cyst of the salivary glands, solitary bone cyst and aneurysmal bone cyst, which are not having a lining. Coming on to the general features of the jaw cyst. Most of the cysts which we are going to study in detail are intraosseous, except the ones which are present in the soft tissue of the head and neck region, for example, your fissural cyst. Some of them may be associated with teeth. For example, the dentigerous cyst, which is arising from the reduced enamel epithelium, it can be totally associated with an impacted tooth. They can be present solitarily or they can be present in group. The multiple cysts, for example, botryoid odontogenic cyst. Biologically, they can be innocuous, symptomless, or they may show slow growth over time, or they may even show mucosal changes if they are rapidly growing. If they are causing any sort of bone expansion, they will lead to gross facial asymmetry. For instance, for the teeth, they can also cause drifting, loosening, resorption. This is common only for the aggressive cysts such as odontogenic keratocysts. They can also undergo secondary infection, which will lead to abscess formation or osteomyelitis, sinus formation, cellulitis or even pathological fractures. Some of the cysts can even undergo carcinomatous changes. For example, dentigerous cyst can transform into squamous cell carcinoma. geographic appearances of the cyst. For example, they can be unilocular around impacted tooth, unilocular with corticated margins, or they can be multilocular. These are the very varied radiographic appearances. You can appreciate an unerupted tooth having a unilocular radiolucency surrounding it. This is also an unerupted tooth with multilocular radiolucency surrounding it. This is a multilocular radiolucency extending into the ramus region in the mandible. This is an unerupted tooth with almost unilocular wide radiolucency. Coming on to the diagnosis of a cyst. The diagnosis of a cyst is based on the clinical radiographical studies. Whatever we are interpreting on the basis of the clinical, that is your age, sex, and the presentation of the patient. Then the radiographic appearances which we have discussed. The biopsy specimen, the gross specimen which we will be seeing whether it is associated with an impacted tooth or not. And the further histological examination. When we are receiving the gross specimen, along with that, we also receive the fluid which is aspirated from that particular cyst. We need to check for the color of that aspirate, the protein content estimation. In that, we can even go detailed protein estimation, that is the albumin and globulin ratios and the levels. And even the cholesterol crystals, which can be seen even with the naked eye or even under the microscope. The cholesterol crystals in the aspirate will appear like shimmery golden crystals. For example, in your radicular or inflammatory cyst, the color of the aspirate is amber with shimmering gold surface. For an odontogenic keratocyst, it is thick, creamy or white cheesy. For other cysts such as aneurysmal bone cyst or central giant cell granuloma, it is blood-tinged. And for traumatic bone cyst, it is empty. These are the various gross appearances of the cyst. You can very well appreciate the gross appearance of the cyst. That is basically what we are appreciating is the mura, the capsule of the cyst. It is more or less attached at the cemento enamel junction of the cyst. In this specimen, we can very well appreciate the cystic lining attached to the cemento enamel junction. These are some of the other specimens which are seen with the impacted tooth associated. This is the creamy fluid which we can appreciate the aspirate, and on preparing a cytological smear of the aspirate, we could appreciate the keratin squams under pap staining. This is the golden shimmery colored aspirate which we could appreciate without staining only the cholesterol crystals. They usually have a broken edge. Coming on to the classification of the cyst. We can classify broadly the cysts as cysts of jaws, cysts associated with maxillary antrum, and the cysts of soft tissue of mouth, face and neck. They can be broadly categorized as epithelial lined and non-epithelial. Under epithelial line, they can be developmental or inflammatory. The developmental further can be divided as odontogenic and non-odontogenic. To name a few, the developmental odontogenic variety, we have gingival cyst of infants and gingival cyst of adults, odontogenic keratocyst, dentigerous cyst, eruption cyst, lateral periodontal cyst, glandular odontogenic cyst, watered odontogenic cyst and calcifying odontogenic cyst. The non-odontogenic variety includes nasopalatine duct cyst, nasolabial cyst and mid-palatine raphe cyst of infants. Under inflammatory category, we have residual cyst, radicular cyst, paradental cyst or inflammatory collateral cyst. Under non-epithelial variety, we have solitary bone cyst and aneurysmal bone cyst. Cysts associated with maxillary antrum are mucocele, retention cyst, pseudocyst and postoperative maxillary cyst. To name a few cysts of the soft tissue of the mouth, face and neck region, we have dermoid cyst, lymphoepithelial cyst, thyroglossal cyst and so on. Coming on to the frequency of distribution of the various cysts of jaw. The most common cyst which we come across is the radicular cyst, since it is associated with any caries lesion, any caries tooth. The second most common cyst is your dentigerous cyst, which is usually associated with impacted teeth. Then we have odontogenic keratocyst. Further, we have residual cyst, paradental cyst, and unclassified odontogenic cyst. If we compare the three major cysts, that is radicular cyst, dentigerous cyst, and odontogenic keratocyst in the maxilla and mandible, we see that in the maxillary anterior region, these cysts are more common, whereas in the mandibular posterior region, these cysts are more common. Pathogenesis of cyst. It can be explained under three major modalities, that is proliferation of the epithelium, the hydrostatic pressure or the osmotic pressure of the cyst fluid, and the resorption of the surrounding bones by various cytokines such as prostaglandins E2, E3 and collagenases. There are various phases through which the cyst forms and enlarges, that is phase of initiation, phase of cyst formation and phase of cyst enlargement. As you can appreciate, this is the source of origin that can be either reduced enamel epithelium, cell rest of serrae, cell rest of malices. This small group of cells proliferate under any influence, which can be genetic or inflammatory. And further, they proliferate because of the release of various cytokines. As they proliferate, they grow and form a ball of mass. As more and more cells proliferate and enlarge itself, the central cells will undergo necrosis because of the lack of oxygen. And there will be a cystic cavity which will be formed inside. The inner cells will cystify. They will undergo necrosis. Further, as the cyst will expand, there will be transudation and exudation from the surrounding stroma, and the cyst will expand. Further, the lining will also release further and further cytokines such as prostaglandins, and the bone will resorb. This is how the cyst will proliferate and expand. In the phase of initiation, the epithelial cell rest, they undergo proliferation through various sources, through various triggers such as bacterial endotoxins, inflammatory mediators, genetic, or they can be loss of immunological surveillance and local factor which cause decreased oxygen tension and increased CO2 tension. In the phase of cyst formation, there will be degeneration of the inner ductal cells due to loss of vascularity, increased intercellular fluid and acid phosphatase activity, accompanied by formation of microcystic cavities. The microcystic cavities further will coalesce to form a large cystic cavity. Lastly, the cyst will grow and expand through majorly three major categories. Basic mechanisms, that is neural growth, hydrostatic enlargement and bone resorbing factors. Under neural growth, we have peripheral cell division and accumulation of cell debris. Under hydrostatic enlargement, we have secretion through the epithelial linings, transudation or exudation of fluid from the surrounding stroma and dialysis. We also have bone resorbing factors. These are the three major theories which have been put forward for cyst enlargement. Looking at them in detail, under peripheral cell division, there is active cell division of the lining epithelium in response to the irritant stimulus. Whatever will be the trigger, for example, bacterial endotoxins in the caries tooth, they will cause more and more active cell division of the lining epithelial in response. But there will be a resistance from the surrounding bone as well. So there can't be just one theory governing the expansion of the cyst. There will be accumulation of the cellular content as the cells will proliferate and form a ball of mass. Example, in odontogenic keratocyst, there will be accumulation of squames from the epithelium. The cyst volume will increase, that is in areas of increased cellular proliferation. perforation and further will cause enlargement. Coming on to hydrostatic enlargement, there can be as discussed secretion, transudation in exudation and dialysis. Secretion can be seen in, for example, dentigerosis, in which in the lining of the cyst there can be presence of certain goblet cells. Goblet cells are mucus producing cells. So if they are going to secrete mucus, it will cause enlargement of the cystic cavity. In transudation and exudation, for example, in inflammatory cysts, there will be increased protein content within the cystic fluid. It will have fibrin, cholesterol because of the hemorrhage of the RBCs, which all will increase the specific gravity of the cystic fluid, and further there will be enlargement of the cystic cavity. Under dialysis, the theory states that the low molecular weight proteins from the epithelium and the products of the degenerating cells of the epithelial cells will increase the osmotic pressure and cause the enlargement of the cystic cavity. These are the diagrams depicting the various theories. Coming on to the last, that is bone resorbing factors, the capsule of the cystic lining may have some blood vessels, and along with that there will be the presence of certain inflammatory cells such as leukocytes. They will release certain bone resorbing factors, that is prostaglandin E2 and E3, which will cause the resorption of the surrounding bone, and that is how the wall of the cells, which was already proliferating, it will expand through the bony cavity. Coming on to the treatment and prognosis of a cyst. Cysts are usually benign in nature, so they can be treated by two major ways, that is either enucleation in total, that we can remove the whole of the cystic lining and the capsule, or they can be marsupialized, which means that the tooth is retained if it is associated with tooth, and only a window is created to remove the lining of the cyst so as to cause less morbidity to the tissues. In certain cases when it is aggressive cyst, for example odontogenic keratosis, we can also do hemimandibulectomy with bone reconstruction. We should always remove the tooth which is associated with the cyst. Most of the cysts have good prognosis except OKC, which is said to have a high recurrence rate. These are the expected questions, that is classification and discussion of the etiopathogenesis of various odontogenic cysts. The various MCQs which can be asked from the topic are: all are developmental in origin except which of the cysts? Radicular cyst, odontogenic keratocyst, dentigerosis or lateral periodontal cyst? As discussed in the classification, it is the radicular cyst which is inflammatory in origin, whereas rest of the three cysts are developmental in origin. The source of epithelial lining in a cyst can be cell rest of malices, cell rest of serrae, basal cell hemartias or all of the above. The right answer is all of the above. All three can give rise to the various cysts. These are the references and the suggested reading. This is the basic mechanism how a cyst forms and expands. There can be any source of origin, for example basal cell hemartia, cell rest of serrae, cell rest of malices or reduced enamel epithelium. Under any influence or trigger, for example genetic event or bacterial endotoxins released from inflammation, those cells can undergo proliferation to form a ball of cell mass. This ball of cell mass now will proliferate by cell division. After it has proliferated, the innermost cells will undergo necrosis because of the lack of vascularity and oxygen supply. Once these cells undergo necrosis, further, this fluid accumulation in the center of the ball of cells will cause increased osmotic activity because of the increased specific gravity, as this is basically nothing but the cellular debris. So as the osmotic activity increases inside the cystic cavity, there will be more of transudation from the surrounding stroma and the cyst will expand. Further, the cystic lining also releases bone resorbing factors which will cause the resorption of the surrounding bone. And this is how a cyst will expand.
There is a pathologic, the growth is there. In this, when we cut it down, we can just see a cystic cavity. And in this cystic cavity, we can just see there is a lumen, there is a lining, and there is a capsule is there. But you can just see the capsule and this area, this is varying in nature. First, you can just see here this nature. This is little bit wider, this is little bit thin. So that is irregularity in the thickness of this lesion, cystic lumen. So cystic lining. So now we have to just also see, concentrate how it is. That means by seeing this, it is important to what it could be. That mostly there is a chances by seeing all these things, you have to see the lining from inside. You can just see little bit irregularity is also there inside. That means some kind of mural proliferation is also there is a possibility of mural proliferation. So in this, there is a chances that mostly the most common cyst which you see is a periapical cyst. And in this periapical cyst, we can just see that the arcading pattern which we see in histopathologically gross, we have to just correlate with these findings. So the chances of periapical cysts are more. And we also consider dentigerous cysts. But in dentigerous cysts, along with this cystic cavity, we have to have an association with the tooth and that is mostly associated with the CEJ. And there is also one thing that is an OKC, but that is mostly the less chances because of the thickness is little bit wider in this, thin it is in that. So that is the thing which we need to focus in our gross specimen.
We are going to discuss the histopathology of various odontogenic cysts. To begin with, we are going to study the histopathology of dentigerous cyst. As you all can appreciate here, you have an empty cavity which depicts the lumen of the cyst. The 2 to 4 cell layer thick lining of the epithelium and the underlying stroma, that is the capsule of the cyst. As you know, in dentigerous cyst, the cystic lining is made up of 2 to 4 cell layer reduced enamel epithelium like lining, and the underlying stroma is made up of mature connected tissue stroma, that is the dense collagen fibers with few interspersed inflammatory cells. Coming on to the histopathology of odontogenic keratocyst, again you can appreciate the empty space which depicts the lumen of the cyst. Then you have a cystic lining and the underlying connective tissue stroma or the capsule. As you can appreciate, the cystic lining is having the basal palisaded nuclei appearing cells, whereas overlying 6 to 10 layered polygonal cells and the topmost corrugated paracantinized layer. Paracantin is the one in which the nuclei are incorporated. You can very well appreciate the corrugations of the paracantin. The underlying stroma, as you see, is loosely arranged. The collagen component is loosely arranged. There are no dense bundles of collagen and there is high inflammatory cell population which you can appreciate along with the blood vessels of varying caliber. Coming on to the histopathology of radicular cyst or the periapical cyst, we have an empty space which depicts the lumen of the cyst. Then we have a stratified squamous epithelium containing cystic lining and the underlying mature connective tissue stroma depicting the capsule of the cyst. If we see the cystic lining, it is thrown up into arcades. That means there are connective tissue cores incorporated within the stratified squamous epithelium. The cystic lining is made up of 6 to 10 layers of stratified squamous epithelium. The underlying stroma is of dense mature connective tissue and there is dense inflammatory cell population of lymphocytes as well.